We're going to get into the next session where we're going to hear from literally the best and brightest of those among us, pun intended, because we're going to hear from Dr. Charisse Best and Dr. Vinette Pearson. And the clinical corner has been one of the aspects on the CARES symposium list that generally gets very good reviews, that a lot of the clinicians in the audience really enjoy this section where we have residents from the University of the West Indies present two special or difficult cases. So first we're going to hear from Dr. Vinette Pearson, who is going to come and speak to us. She is a product of Montego Bay, so she's in her, you know, in her home ground, so to speak. And just very briefly, Dr. Pearson, she has a BSc honors, which she got in 2005 with a major in biochemistry. So she's a girl after my own heart, since that's what I did. And afterwards, she got her MBBS in 2011 with an honors degree. And notably, she got the John Hall Book Prize in Medicine. I did not know that. I don't see, is John Hall here? No, he's not here, but I guess he would have been glad to hear that. After which she did a house officer stint at Cornell Regional Hospital, and she has been a medical resident at UWI since 2013 with an interest in doing a fellowship in endocrinology later on. So could you please welcome Dr. Vinette Pearson, who's going to do a case presentation involving multiple endocrine neoplasia, MEN. Welcome.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I will be doing the presentation on The Answer Lies Within the Genes. The case presentation is that of a 19-year-old student, Ms. KB. She initially presented to our institution in June of 2000 to the surgical outpatient department for evaluation of a right thyroid nodule. This was noted for approximately 2 months and was described as being firm, non-tender, mobile, and superficial to the thyroid with no other adenopathy. And the plan at that time was for her to have a thyroid ultrasound followed by fine needle aspiration and cytology. 2 months subsequently, she began to complain of headaches associated with tremor, hot flushes, and palpitations, which occurred at a frequency of approximately 2 to 3 times per week. The thyroid ultrasound showed an 8 millimeter nodule in the lower left lobe, a 17 millimeter nodule in the right lobe, with foci of calcifications noted within the nodules. She also had a 1.6 centimeter mass, which was suggestive of a lymph node lateral to the right internal jugular vein, and the impression was that of a multinodular goiter. She was biochemically euthyroid at that time. Fine needle aspiration cytology was done, initially was inadequate for a diagnosis, but subsequently revealed a nodular goiter with degeneration. Approximately 10 months after her initial presentation, she reported a 2-year history of sweating with weakness relieved by ingestion of something sweet, suggestive of hypoglycemic symptoms, and had noted that these symptoms had been increasing over the ensuing months. And the consideration at that time was whether or not she may have an insulinoma and whether or not this may be associated with a familial syndrome such as MEN. She was sent for the following biochemical investigations: calcium, parathyroid hormone, prolactin, fasting insulin, fasting C-peptide, and fasting glucose. All were within normal limits. A urinary VMA that was elevated, as well as plasma metanephrine. The actual quantitative result was not available. And her AM and PM cortisol were also within normal limits. This was later followed by an abdominal CT scan, which had shown a well-defined 6.3 by 5 by 4.8 centimeter hypodense mass in the left suprarenal area posterior to the stomach. A normal left suprarenal gland was not identified. And her other intra-abdominal organs were reported as normal. She was electively admitted and prepped for an adrenalectomy. after which the endocrine team was initially consulted. So the endocrine team met a very slim young female who essentially had a relatively unremarkable systemic examination. Physically, she was found to have an arm span of approximately 180 centimeters and a height of 175 centimeters. Closer examination of the oral cavity, she was noted to have a high arched palate, as well as multiple mucosal nodules to the tip of her tongue. We also found that she had a significant family history. Her father had passed away, unfortunately, at the time of her admission from anaplastic thyroid carcinoma. He was also thought to have pheochromocytoma based on an elevated urinary VMA, as well as a CT adrenal, which had shown an adrenal mass. Her older sister had also died, unfortunately, from a thyroid cancer, and she had two older siblings who were apparently in good health. 17 months later, she was booked for a left adrenalectomy for pheochromocytoma, and she also had an excisional biopsy of her right cervical lymph node. A preoperative evaluation by the endocrine service, there was recommendation for alpha blockade with phenoxybenzamine, 10 milligrams twice daily, followed by atenolol, 50 milligrams once daily, preoperative calcitonin, as well as recommendation for bilateral adrenalectomy. Her intraoperative period was relatively unremarkable except for a brief period of hypertensive crisis on manipulation of her adrenal gland, and the postoperative period was not significant for any episodes of hypotension or hypoglycemia. 1 month after her adrenalectomy, she was booked for total thyroidectomy and right radical neck dissection. Grossly, she was found to have an enlarged, firm, irregular thyroid, which was adherent to the prevertebral fascia, an irregularly occurring right recurrent laryngeal nerve, and a mass to the right external laryngeal nerve. And there was also noted to be a prominent lymphatic channel leading to the superior mediastinum. So histology confirmed a pheochromocytoma, ganglioneuromatosis of the vermiform appendix, as well as the lymph node revealed metastatic carcinoma consistent with thyroid origin. The thyroid showed histological features of medullary thyroid carcinoma in the right lobe. It was noted to have low mitotic activity. The tumor approximated the capsule, however, there was no pericapsular extension. The resection margins were uninvolved. Medullary thyroid carcinoma was seen in 8 of the 28 cervical nodes, and the thymus was reported as unremarkable. She later completed 6 weeks of external beam radiation to the neck, and in the latter part was complicated by dysphonia. She had indirect laryngoscopy, which revealed edematous changes to her vocal cords. There was a consideration of whether or not she may have paresis of the right cord, and she was also noted to have a residual right paratracheal mass, and they entertained the possibility of recurrence. This was later followed after radiation therapy by a repeat study, which was reported as essentially normal. So the plan by the endocrinology service was that she have continued observation with respect to surveillance for pheochromocytoma in the contralateral adrenal, postoperative calcitonin levels approximately 3 months after radiotherapy in order to document the adequacy of her previous resection, and RET proto-oncogene testing to determine her clinical course. However, the cost was significantly prohibitive to the family, and the siblings were subsequently asked to come in for neck examination, pheochromocytoma screening, and a stimulated calcitonin testing. When the patient eventually did her post-operative calcitonin levels, they were noted to be markedly elevated, greater than 600 picograms per mil. We did a neck ultrasound, which was negative for macroscopic disease of the thyroid, and the recommendation was made for a CT scan of the neck and the chest. It had revealed an ill-defined homogeneous soft tissue thickening to the inferior aspect of the left side of the neck, which deviated the trachea to the right, as well as there were 3 small upper lobe lung parenchymal lesions, which were suggestive of metastases. Unfortunately, our patient defaulted from follow-up, but had stated when we initially saw her again in 2012 that she had continued outpatient follow-up with a general practitioner, where she continued to have thyroid hormone replacement therapy with calcium and vitamin D. She represented approximately 12 years later with syncopal events over a 3-month interval with recurrence of the symptoms that she had initially presented in 2000. CT brain revealed bilateral acute and chronic subdural hematomas and her sulfalcine herniation to the left, and she subsequently had a burr hole procedure done without any cardiovascular crisis. She was biochemically euthyroid and she had an isolated VMA was noted to be 86 elevated, but this was not on a thyramine restricted diet. The opportunity at that time was taken to repeat her CT abdomen and chest. The impression was metastatic lung disease. There was also a notation of a round soft tissue mass in the left adrenal bed, which may represent a nodule or recurrence, and indeterminate nodules in the right adrenal gland. Now, this case highlights the genetic condition of multiple endocrine neoplasia type 2, which is a familial cancer syndrome caused by mutations in the red proto-oncogene. It's inherited as an autosomal dominant disorder that's characterized by tumors arising from neuroendocrine cells. There are three subtypes: multiple endocrine neoplasia type 2A, that's characterized by medullary thyroid carcinoma, pheochromocytoma, and hyperparathyroidism. 2B, that's characterized by medullary thyroid carcinoma, pheochromocytoma, and a distinct phenotype characterized by mucosal neuromas, a marfanoid habitus, ganglioneuromas of the gastrointestinal tract, and non-MEN familial medullary thyroid carcinoma. Now, the management of MEN2B requires a multidisciplinary approach with the endocrinologist at the center of management. Now, we see just over a third of previously untreated medullary thyroid carcinoma patients reveal false negative findings during the preoperative neck evaluation via ultrasonography. These false negative findings occur more often in the central than the lateral neck compartment. And if we recall, our patient's initial thyroid ultrasound was suggestive of a multinodular goiter. A study by Tromboli et al. Looking at the detection rate of fine needle aspiration cytology in medullary thyroid carcinoma did a meta-analysis looking at 15 articles between the period of 2004 and 2015. The detection rate with medullary thyroid carcinoma on a per lesion basis analysis ranged from approximately 12.5% to 82.2%. And the conclusion was that approximately 56% of histologically proven medullary thyroid carcinoma were correctly detected by cytologic evaluation. Now, the treatment for symptomatic pheochromocytoma, this ideally should be removed prior to surgery for any other neuroendocrine tumors. If the patient has a unilateral disease, recommendation is for unilateral adrenalectomy. However, there may be a role for subtotal adrenalectomy to preserve the adrenal cortical function and should be considered as an alternative procedure, but this is associated with a 20% risk of recurrence within 20 years. Medullary thyroid carcinoma that's confined to the neck and cervical nodes should have a total thyroidectomy with dissection of the central lymph node compartment and dissection of the involved lateral neck compartments. If the preoperative imaging is positive in the ipsilateral lateral neck compartment, but negative in the contralateral compartment, contralateral neck dissection should be considered if the serum calcitonin level is greater than 200. We unfortunately weren't privy to a preoperative calcitonin or index case. Now, perioperative calcitonin plays a major role in the management of patients with this genetic syndrome. It's useful in determining the extent of lymph node metastases. A study was done looking at 300 consecutive patients with medullary thyroid carcinoma who were treated by total thyroidectomy and compartment-oriented lymph node dissections. And virtually it was found that there was no risk of lymph node metastases when the preoperative serum calcitonin level was less than 20. For those who had levels exceeding 20, 50, 200, and 500 respectively, there were metastases to the ipsilateral central and ipsilateral lateral neck, the contralateral central neck, the contralateral lateral neck, and the upper mediastinum, Our patient had a post-operative calcitonin level greater than 600, and if you recall grossly, she had evidence of quite significant lymphatic channels leading to the superior mediastinum. So we can assume that her preoperative calcitonin level would have been markedly elevated. External beam radiation therapy is a recommendation, usually based on clinical judgment, especially for persons in whom you may consider having a high risk of recurrence or those with such as those who may have presented with significant metastases. The life expectancy in medullary thyroid carcinoma is approximately 78% to 91% at 5 years and approximately 75% at 10 years. And despite this relatively high survival rate, only approximately a third of these patients are biochemically cured at surgery. And bearing in mind, this can cause some anxiety to both the patient and the clinician, as elevated calcitonin levels may suggest recurrence of disease. Red proto-oncogene testing is quite beneficial in management of these patients. Point mutations that occur specifically at codon 918 tend to be seen specifically in persons with MEN2B. The red proto-oncogene is a transmembrane tyrosine area, and it's typically found on chromosome 10. Apart from the codon at 918 that is specific for 2B, codon showing point mutations at 768 and position 804 may be associated with non-MEN familial medullary thyroid carcinoma. And some point mutations may result in different clinical manifestations in the same family or in different families, suggesting that other genetic changes or modifiers were responsible for the phenotypic differences. Genetic counseling should be recommended for first-degree relatives of patients with proven hereditary medullary thyroid carcinoma and patients whose infants or young children have the classic phenotype of MEN2B. Now, this table shows the risk of aggressive medullary thyroid carcinoma based on genotype and the recommended interventions. Highlighted is a point mutation at position 918, which is typically seen in patients with the MEN2B genetic syndrome. These patients, they tend to prophylactically recommend surgical excision of the thyroid as soon as possible within the first year of life, and screening for pheochromocytoma is usually recommended at the age of 8 years. This table summarizes the management guidelines according to the American Thyroid Association for the management of medullary thyroid carcinoma. Starting with the person that presents with a thyroid nodule, ideally they should have a neck ultrasound and same followed by fine needle aspiration cytology with certain biochemical tests done, such as the serum calcitonin as well as evaluation for hyperparathyroidism or ferrochromocytoma with PTH, calcium, and metanephrine levels, as well as DNA analysis with RET oncogene testing. If the person is found to be RET negative but calcitonin levels is less than 500, a total thyroidectomy is recommended plus or minus cervical lymph node dissection depending on the above investigations that would have been previously done. If the person is red proto-oncogene positive with any evidence of pheochromocytoma, this should be removed prior to any other surgical procedure, subsequently followed in the presence of METC by the total thyroidectomy plus or minus external radiation therapy, depending on what the assessment by the surgical team as well as the radiation oncologist, whether or not there's evidence of extensive disease, metastases, etc. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Pearson. And we're asking if you have any questions for the case, or so hold it until the next presentation by Dr. Charisse Best. At the Caribbean Endocrine Society, being a Caribbean organization, we embrace everyone, including,
I had a question.
Yeah.
Later on.
Okay. Are you able to, will you be here for another 15 minutes?
Absolutely.
Oh, then we'll take it right there. You'll be the first one. Well, we're going to welcome Dr. Charisse Best, and she's from Barbados, so to help to enforce our Caribbean mandate. And she was so bright that after high school, she went straight to medical school. She didn't do it in Barbados, she did it here in Mono, right? And she graduated in 2012, she was on a dean's list, and she's now a medical resident. What I found interesting is that she's a member of the Shaolin Dragon School of Kung Fu. So you better not mess with her, but she's going to come and tell us about adrenal carcinoma or adrenal cancer. So could we just welcome Dr. Charisse Best? And after her presentation, we'll take the questions.
Okay, good afternoon. I'm just going to tell you about a case of a vasculitic rash. The index case of that is that a 51-year-old female who was a school teacher by profession. She complained of a six-month history of erythematous non-pruritic rash initially to her trunk, which then extended to her upper limbs and to her legs. On that visit, she also complained of a one-year history of alopecia, increased facial hair, and weight gain. She also had generalized weakness and difficulty concentrating. Of significance, she denied any history of headaches, no visual disturbances or insomnia. She had no changes in her mood, no discharges from her nipples, or no changes to her regular menstrual cycles. She had a past medical history significant for hypertension, for which she was taking Losartan 50 milligrams once a day. She was allergic to penicillin, but no other drug allergies, and she had no personal or family history of any autoimmune conditions or endocrinopathies. On examination, she was comfortable, her mucous membranes were pale but moist, and her significant vital signs included a blood pressure of 167 on 117 and a pulse rate of 113. Her BMI at that time was 35.6. Present was mild alopecia. She had increased papules to her face with facial hair noted. She also had dorsal and supraclavicular fat pads noted, and she had a erythematous non-blanching rash to her trunks, arms, and legs. Significant negatives were the absence of acanthosis nigricans. She also had no pathological striae. She had power 5/5 throughout with normal visual field testing, no galacturia on examination, and her thyroid examination was normal. She had had tests done about 1 year prior to this, including a complete blood count, urine and electrolytes, LFTs, thyroid function tests, and an HbA1c, which were all negative. And on this visit, she had a skin biopsy test, which was suggestive of a leukocytoclastic vasculitis. She also had a repeat collagen vascular screen, CRP, and urinalysis, as well as complement levels, which were normal. Her CBC was only significant for an elevated white cell count at 14.3. Her fasting blood glucose at the time was elevated at 8.6, and her HbA1c was 8.9. She went on to further have other investigations done, including a prolactin level, LH, FSH, and estradiol levels, which were all normal. Her TFTs were significant for a low total T4, but her TSH and total T3 were normal. Of significance, however, her total testosterone was noted to be elevated at 2.13, with the upper limit of normal being 1.3. So, in summary, we have a 51-year-old female with a history of hypertension who presented with essentially features of androgenism for a year. She also had features of Cushing syndrome for a year and presented with a leukocytoclastic vasculitic rash for 6 months. So what could be her differential diagnosis? And she also had an elevated serum testosterone. So high on my list would be an adrenal cortical carcinoma, co-secretion of both cortisol and testosterone could account for her symptoms that she was having. Her leukocytoclastic rash could also be due to underlying secondary malignancy. This is also due to the fact that her autoimmune investigations were negative. We also need to consider polycystic ovarian syndrome. She did have signs of increased weight gain. She had signs of virilization. However, it usually doesn't present in this age group, and she had no symptoms of any irregular menses. We have to consider Cushing syndrome as well, but this wouldn't account for her increased androgenism and her increased testosterone levels. As we had heard before, she could have congenital adrenal hyperplasia, even though she is 51, but it would have to be a very mild form. And this usually presents, of course, with symptoms of virilization, but she should still have complained of symptoms of oligomenorrhea. We have to also consider pheochromocytoma. It wouldn't encompass all of her systems, but she did present with an increased blood pressure and tachycardia on presentation. Her continued investigations included a total testosterone, which was repeated and remained elevated at 2.83. She had a DHEAS test, which was elevated as well at 903. This led us to think that her increased androgens was coming from her adrenal gland. So we went on to do a CT abdomen and pelvis, and these were her results. She actually had a 7x6x5 mass in her left adrenal gland with a small tiny foci of microcalcification found there as well. Her Huntsman units in terms of attenuation was 40. And when contrast was used, it was heterogeneous in appearance and there was also a small cystic component as well. In terms of the appearance of other organs, they were all normal and there was no ascites or lymphadenopathy noted. So because of the size and because of the unfavorable characteristics on CT, she then became a candidate for surgery. Her other investigations, pre-surgical workup, included a plasma ACTH, which was normal. She had a 24-hour urinary cortisol, which was also normal, but went on to do a 1 mg dexamethasone suppression test, which, as you can see, was high. Her 8 mg dexamethasone suppression test was also high, and she had VMAs done, which were normal. She had no urinary or serum metanephrine tests done, and this was because of financial constraints. In terms of her perioperative period, it was unremarkable. She had laparotomy with a left adrenalectomy done. Her perioperative period was covered with steroids, and it was then weaned and discontinued, and her serum cortisol remained normal after this. The histology showed a tumor size of 6x5x4.5 cm. There were areas of necrosis with invasion of the capsules and the margins were thought to be involved, but there were no lymph, vascular, or perineural invasions identified. Her Ki-67 antigen score was 1% and the impression was adrenocortical carcinoma with T3, N0, M0. Her investigations post-surgery included a CBC, which was non-normal, her DHEA test, total testosterone, and her serum 8 a.m. cortisol, and her fasting glucose were all also normal. So, determination of adjuvant therapy and monitoring in patients with adrenocortical carcinoma, we first have to look at the prognosis of the patient. Among the various clinical parameters that have been shown to impact the adrenocortical carcinoma prognosis, tumor staging has been shown to be one of the most important. Of those used, the most common is that formulated in 2008 by the European Network for the Study of Adrenal Tumors, and we note that the higher the stage correlates with poorer prognosis. Our patient had T3, N0, M0, putting her at a stage 3. Regardless of the stage, incomplete resection is associated with a poor prognosis. The influence of margin status on prognosis was actually shown in a report from the National Cancer Database in a 5-year overall survival rates for patients with adrenocortical carcinomas. And it showed that those who had uninvolved, microscopically involved, and macroscopically involved margins were 46, 21, and 10% respectively. Older age and hypersecretion of cortisol in these tumors are also related to adverse factors. We also have to look at the pathological features of the tumors. And many of these are associated with the parameters used in the well-known West criteria, which we usually use to help aid us in a diagnosis of adrenal cortical carcinoma. They can include the nuclear grade, the mitotic rate, diffuse architecture, whether there's necrosis, whether there's venous invasion, sinusoidal invasion, or any capsular invasion. Other markers of prognosis include markers of proliferation, including your Ki-67 antigen expression. Those patients who have a Ki-67 expression of more than 10% tend to have a higher risk of recurrence and a poor prognosis. Adjuvant treatment is actually suggested for patients who have a higher risk of recurrence, and that is thought to be those who have incomplete resection, or Ki-67 staining of more than 10% of your tumor cells, more than 20 mitotic figures for 50 high power field, regardless of the tumor size, inoperative tumor spillage, or if there are any fractures, and some large tumors that are low grade but have vascular or capsular invasion. Mitotane is usually the drug of choice for adjuvant treatment. It is actually a derivative of the insecticide DDT and is directly toxic on the adrenal cortical parenchyma. It has anti-carticolytic action and inhibits steroid synthesis, and the usual therapeutic range is usually 14 to 20 micrograms per liter. Optimal duration is actually not known, but usually for patients with low-risk adrenal cortical carcinoma, the minimum of 2 years is generally used. It must be realized that the efficacy for this drug in these cancers are usually come from a lot of observational and retrospective studies using a small volume of patients. There are still ongoing trials trying to ascertain better efficacies in terms of randomized trials for the use of mitotane in these patients. We need to remember that mitotane has lots of side effects. Its availability is also a problem, especially for patients in Jamaica, and this is a very expensive drug for our patients. In terms of its adverse effects, the most common ones would be your GI effects, for example, the nausea, GI upset that they may have, or your CNS effects such as confusion, ataxia, or dizziness that they may have. These patients usually require glucocorticoid replacement, and they may or may not require mineral corticoid replacement, and for our males, testosterone replacement, and need to be monitored in terms of their liver function tests, thyroid function tests, their urea and electrolytes, and their complete blood counts very regularly, and treatment put in place if any abnormalities are found. In terms of monitoring of the patients post-surgery, there are no real international recommendations for follow-up. However, small groups have their guidelines, and one of the European guidelines include or recommend follow-up every 3 months using either abdominal CT or MRI of the abdomen, a thoracic CT, and monitoring of the initially elevated steroids for these patients. Once the patient shows no sign of recurrence, after 2 years, the interval for monitoring can be gradually increased. In the cases of long-term persistence of disease-free status, follow-up should be continued for at least 10 years. So in summary, we need to consider adrenal cortical carcinoma in patients who show signs of steroid excess, and thorough laboratory workup is necessary prior to the removal to avoid any serious complications preoperatively. Monitoring is also needed even after surgery, given their risk of recurrence. These are my references. Thank you.
Could we have another round of applause for both presenters? Great. Thank you very much for those two cases. And Professor Arafat.
You've heard, actually, two excellent residents who I think will make superb endocrinologists in the future. And I think they deserve a lot of credit for the clarity that they presented these very interesting cases. Now, having said that, I have a couple of questions to push a little bit. For Dr. Peterson, what would you do if you were the very first person who saw this particular patient? Like, you know, there were plenty of people who saw this patient. Let's say you were the first one to see her. You've noted all these features and findings. What would you have done differently that would have made a difference in her life?
Well, when the patient had initially presented with the thyroid nodule, of course, she would have had the thyroid ultrasound done. But she did have ultrasonography findings suggestive of a non-benign lesion. She had nodules. She had one in particular that exceeded 1 centimeter. And as mentioned before from Prof. Wright-Pascoe's presentation, there was also evidence of calcification within the nodules as well. Given the fact that she also had a family history of such invasive disease that would highly bring to your top differential a familial syndrome, possibly. The fact that her father also had a pheochromocytoma at that point in time, or findings suggestive of same, initially the familial syndrome of NEM would have come to my top differential.
Absolutely.
At that point in time.
Now, I mean, the point that I hope I would keep with you is the biopsy was done, it was benign, or read as benign. I don't think you should, or anybody should stop right there in somebody who is that young, who has that kind of a history. And you also have a lymph node that should mm-hmm. not have been there to start with. So I would kind of lean immediately to that direction. It's an accessible thing, it's very easy to take. But you've done a wonderful job whenever you picked her up, and I think you deserve a lot of credit for that. For Cherise, I actually have a different question. And that is, you presented a wonderful case of somebody who has excess androgens, specifically DHEAS, and some clinical features of Cushing's and poor suppressibility with dexamethasone. Yet I've noted that the ACTH is normal, and actually high normal. That kind of bothers me a little bit, and I wonder whether you have any explanation for that. Because it contradicts totally with the dexamethasone suppression.
Okay, so we did realize that the ACTH was normal. Some of the schools of thought were that her tumor could actually be one of the rare tumors that are actually secreting ACTH itself.
Good for you.
She could also have a concomitant Cushing's disease, or it could just be a laboratory error as well.
Okay. The point that I'm trying to make is, you know, you had a big-sized tumor. And I think from what I presented earlier, always look at the other side. Look at the other adrenal. If this was producing cortisol, the other adrenal should be totally suppressed and shrunken down. So looking at that other adrenal would have been really great. You know, it's possible that she was secreting ACTH maybe from that cancer itself, because these cancers can do it too. But, you know, I suspect that probably an assay issue. And ACTH assays are notorious for being a problem in people who have anti-mouse antibodies. So your patient could have easily had anti-mouse antibodies. I mean, I know you didn't check for it, but that's the only way I can actually put the two together to proceed that this is truly only cortisol-producing carcinoma. Well done, though. Excellent, actually. Thank you.
And to even follow up on Prof's point, that point about the ACTH has not been lost, I think this is the third adrenal carcinoma case we have seen in the last 3 or 4 years. And in all three of them, the ACTH has been either inappropriately normal or even slightly elevated.
I would suggest you pursue that because this becomes very publishable.
Yes.
You can put yourself on a paper in the future.
Yes. Great. Thank you. Other questions? Marshall.
My last question is, and then is just about for the patient. Does she have any, the Dr. Pearson's patient, did she have any children? Or if she were to think about pregnancy, would there be any special advice that you'd want to give her? I don't know.
Well, as far as I'm concerned, I don't think she has any children. I'm not really sure what her future prospect is with respect to future pregnancies, but the fact that she has a contralateral adrenal present, the fact that she had symptoms that may have been suggestive of episodic hyperadrenergic symptoms when she presented in 2012. Pregnancy can precipitate a pheochromocytoma crisis. Of course, there's also the role for genetic counseling, the fact that she also has a strong family history, and her presentation, which is suggestive of MEN2B, there is a strong role for genetic testing if she could have afforded it, but there is a high penetrance rate, and it's likely that her offspring will present with this syndrome as well.
Great. It seems there is no other questions. And if that's the case, could we again thank our presenters? And at this point in time, I'm going to allow Professor Tolori to come and give the vote of thanks. And I'm sure UDOC wants me to repeat again. Dinner at what time? Seven. Cost is? Free. There you go. Thank you very much. I don't know where the location is.
Where the location was, but I think we'll be directed. The East Lawn. Near to Choices. Okay, I saw them setting up earlier. Okay, excellent. All right, so it's interesting because I'm ending where I started. This is what I did the first year we had a CARES meeting, the vote of thanks, and I've always hoped that I could avoid this task for many years, but I guess if you've been around long enough, you end up getting the things you don't like to do more than once. So this is always a hard task because you have to be brief, people are tired, you don't want to miss out anybody important. But I think one of the things we'll all agree on is that we've had another wonderful conference, an excellent meeting, and it's really a pleasure on this occasion to give the vote of thanks. So first of all, we'd like to thank all our speakers for taking time out of their busy academic and clinical schedules to participate in this meeting. This is actually the ninth symposium that we've put on. And as you know, this symposium is a high point of our calendar. We know that our speakers, I'm sure you'll agree, have given us a lot of food for thought. And their presentations have been of an extremely high standard, very well organized. And they've continued to set the tone for future meetings. So we look forward to having you back with us again, all our speakers, Dr. Arafa, Professor Arafa, and others who are in their infancy as participants in future meetings. We also like to thank our sponsors. I use this all the time about cash to care, but those are very immortal words. And it's very good that we have some faithful sponsors. One we'll have to mention is Merck Sharp and Dohme, who have been our platinum sponsor and have sponsored us for every one of the 9 years so far. And they've promised to do something extra special for the 10th year, for the 10th symposium. So I'm going to hold them to that. We'd also like to thank Merck Serono as well, who have been one of our main sponsors. And then we also have to thank Sanofi Aventis, Abbott Pharmaceuticals, and we'd like to also welcome AstraZeneca. This is their first year at CARES. We also like to thank the Tropical Medicine Research Institute for its support and University of the West Indies for a lot of the things that we don't see happening around us. We'd also like to single out the Secretariat, Mr. Hanif Smith, and his team from SMTC for their help in getting this program together and making the arrangements for the speakers and other things, as well as the members of the UDOC Planning Committee who have continued to give us the support over the years. And of course, the CARES executive, of which I'm still a part, so I'm thanking myself, but I'll still take credit, deserves thanks for their hard work. We had a lot of meetings, most of them by Zoom, so because we're a little spread out this year. Our president is in Trinidad, and our vice president is here today. And then, of course, we'd like to thank the hotel, the Hyatt Ziva, for making us feel at home and providing us with a wonderful atmosphere. And finally, we'd like to thank you all for coming once again, supporting the meeting. And we look forward to seeing you again at our next meeting. And of course, feel free to bring others and tell them about what you've learned. Thanks very much.